the circuitry to give rise to the problem. You can't understand how to do, or the meaning of the neurological exam unless you know the circuitry that's responsible for allowing you to do those things. So this three-week course is designed to do two things. One is we'll teach you the circuitry, and it's not a comprehensive circuitry. It's a need-to-know stuff. And then we'll get a little bit of the basic sciences done this week. And then next week, we'll move into more of the clinical aspects of neurology. And the third week, you have an SPBL and a few more lectures. So the first and third weeks are pretty light. The next week's going to be pretty tough. But you'll have 2 weeks for the exam. There are two exams in this course. One will be next Monday, and the syllabus is posted on D2L. You'll have one exam next Monday. It'll be light. And then you'll have 2 weeks to study for the next. So we're going to spend this week on spinal cord and brainstem, and then next week we'll get into higher cortical function. And so it's kind of a progressive type thing. Any questions about the syllabus or the SPBL does not count part of your grade. You know that it's just the two exams. Any questions about neurology? Okay, so we're going to start today with spinal cord. And then Professor Paul is going to come down to do a little bit of the physiology. But first, the golf tournament yesterday was pretty fun. It was rather warm. But the student team and our team finished the same, next to the bottom. Where is the Royal and Ancient Golf Club located? Say it out loud if you know it. Where?
Ireland?
What is the town
of
the Royal and Ancient Golf Club? Not Edinburgh.
Oh, where is the Masters
on that?
It's
in Augusta. Well, that's Augusta.
What is it?
Augusta. But that's enough.
It's Scotland.
You guys don't know this?
No.
We're the first, the oldest golf courses? Well, somebody, Taylor, you're the Google queen. Get after her. Say it out loud if you get it.
Musselburgh.
Where?
Musselburgh Links.
No.
The old golf course.
The Royal and Ancient Golf Club.
St. Andrews.
All right.
Scotland.
So if I come up with a couple more, I've got a couple more prizes here. lecture objectives here for the next couple of hours. We're going to go over the gross anatomy, a little bit of the spinal cord, and then we'll get into the cytoarchitecture. There are a few nuclear groups we'll talk about in the spinal cord, mostly nuclear groups, though, when we get up to the brainstem. But we'll be talking a lot about the white matter tracts today, and then the variations from top to bottom.
Are they sharing?
It's a Teach for America cult. And so then we'll get into, toward the end, clinically relevant tracts of the cord. Going back to the anatomy of the cord, we remember from gross anatomy, we have the H-shaped gray matter surrounded by the white matter. The white matter is called white matter because of the myelination of most of the fibers. These are the tracts, or the fibers, that are running up and down the spinal cord. They're going to surround the gray matter. At each segmental level, remember, you have rootlets that come out to form the dorsal and ventral roots. It's not a single root that comes out, it's just rootlets. So what you have to envision with the spinal cord is that you have a three-dimensional column of cells from top to bottom. So it's not, when you see cross sections of the spinal cord, it's easy to see them in two dimensions. This, the gray matter is three dimensions from top to bottom. There are a couple of bumps on the cord that you need to be aware of. On the posterior aspect, the dorsal aspect of the cord, in the midline you have a median sulcus, a posterior median sulcus, and on the anterior side you have an anterior median fissure. Coming down from the posterior median sulcus is a septum that will go down almost to the gray matter. Now lateral to that, immediately lateral to that, you have another sulcus here. This is the posterior intermediate sulcus. And then lateral to that is another sulcus, posterior lateral sulcus. On the ventral side, you have the fissure, and then you have an anterior lateral sulcus. You don't have an intermediate. Now, these sulci are important only because things happen there. On the lateral sulci is where you'll find the dorsal and ventral rootlets. The intermediate sulcus on the posterior aspect is where you'll find the posterior spinal artery. It sits in that groove. The anterior spinal artery sits in the groove formed by the fissure. And in the middle of the H-shaped structure is a hole. And that's the spinal canal. It's a tiny, tiny, tiny hole that is filled with cerebrospinal fluid and communicates with the fourth ventricle up in the brainstem. So you've got the lateral ventricle, the third ventricle, the fourth ventricle, and at the inferior point of the fourth ventricle, it continues down as the central canal. And it has clinical relevance that I'll show you at the very end. Remember that the adult spinal cord stops at the L2 vertebral level. Okay. So covering the spinal cord are the three meninges. Outermost would be the dura, you remember that. Attached to the back side of the dura is the arachnoid. This is the same picture you're going to see up in the brain. So when we talk about pathophysiology tomorrow, if we're talking about an epidural hematoma, that's outside the dura. If we're talking about a subdural hematoma, realize you've got to create that space. You've got to separate the dura from the arachnoid, because it's not normally there, the potential space. And then, of course, deep to the arachnoid is where you'll find the CSF. and the outermost covering of the spinal cord, as well as all of the rootlets, would be the pia. The pia goes down into the anterior fissure. The arachnoid dura do not. You guys remember the dorsal root ganglion? Dorsal root ganglion? From C2 all the way down to the sacral cord, housing the cell bodies of somatic, visceral, sensory neurons. Just want to call your attention to it because we'll bring it up later on. Okay. So if we look at a cross-section of the spinal cord here, pieces and parts that are important here. We have the dura and the arachnoid, the blue. There's the pia, the blue, adherent to the cord. Remember the denticulate ligaments that prevent the side-to-side motion or anchor the cord side-to-side? What anchors the cord inferiorly? Phylum terminale.
Woohoo!
We got a hat. All right. Okay. So if you look at the cross section of the cord here, it's the white matter is divided into three regions: a posterior, a lateral, and a ventral funiculus. Funiculus is a group of fibers that don't all have the same function or purpose. It's just a large anatomical grouping. That's as opposed to a fasciculus, which is a bundle of fibers with the same purpose. Right? A fascicle, the same person, a funiculus is just a region. The gray matter is divided into 10 sections or areas called rexed, R-E-X-E-D, rexed lamina. Rexed, in about 1950 or so, created this nomenclature because if you look at the spinal cord, both anatomically and physiologically, these regions are distinct. They have certain purposes and characteristics that distinguish them. Okay? So rex and lamina, 1 through 10. And then you have the central canal in the middle. Around the gray matter here, you see this band that goes all the way around it. It's called the fasciculus propreus. Fasciculus propreus. A fasciculus, as I just said, is a bundle of fibers with the same purpose. The fasciculus propreus, what it does is it attaches or allows for communication between one level of the spinal cord and another, sort of an internal circuitry. Now, one thing about neuro that I'll probably bring up later on is when you do all these other systems, cardiovascular system, pulmonary system, that's all they do. Cardiovascular system pumps blood. Pulmonary system, you breathe in and out. Nothing new. The nervous system, you not only have the circuits there that enable you to do things, but it goes a step further and allows you to calculate, to memorize, to love, to do things that are so abstract, nobody really knows how it works. So that's why I like the nervous system and can't stand any of the others. Okay. There's one area, one final area on this slide here. It's called the anterior white commissure. A commissure is a bundle of fibers that links one part to another. You have a bunch of commissures up in the brain, but the one in the spinal cord that's most important is the anterior white commissure, and that's in front of the little H, the crossbar of the H. That little area right there is called the anterior white commissure, it, believe it or not, it's a small area, but it plays a vital role that you'll see here in just a minute. You see that the posterior funiculus is divided by that septum from the intermediate sulcus into a lateral and a medial. You see right there? There are two. I'll explain that in just a second, but it's clear on this slide. So if we talk about the blood supply of the spinal cord, this is really important. It all comes from, the majority of it comes from the vertebral arteries. You remember the right-left vertebral arteries, as they go through the foramen magnum, each artery will give off a branch ventrally to form the anterior spinal artery. As I mentioned, travels in the anterior fissure. You can't really see it on this this slide here, but right there is the posterior spinal. You see the posterior spinals come off and wrap around the spinal cord and again travel in the intermediate sulcus. If you look down here on this cross section, you've got the anterior spinal and the two posterior spinals right there. Now, as you go down the spinal cord, at each segmental level, the segmental artery is going to provide what are called radicular arteries. Wow. Ridicular.
Can you start with that section?
Yeah. This course is neurology. So, at each, as the anterior and posterior spinal arteries are traveling down, they receive contributions from the segmental arteries. And as you see right here, this has a segmental artery. This could be an intercostal artery. So it gives off little branches back towards the nervous system to help supplement the anterior and posterior spinal. Now, once you get down to about the end of the thoracic area, though, thoracic vertebra, right down around here, there is a large radicular artery that comes off of the left side. It's a segmental artery, comes off of the left side, and it feeds the lower spinal cord. You can see it right here in this arteriogram. It's the one that goes up and back down to join the anterior spinal. It's called the artery of Adamkiewicz, or Adamkiewicz, I don't know how you say it. Is it on there somewhere?
It's right there.
Oh yeah, right there. Mm-hmm. Okay, I think I might have mentioned this in anatomy. The point about this is that it comes off right there at the renal arteries, and it supplies the part of the spinal cord that controls the lower extremities. So if you're doing a renal arteriogram looking for secondary hypertension and you flood the renal arteries with a bunch of chalky contrast material and it goes up into this artery and occludes the artery, what you wind up with is paralysis. So it's very important to know where this artery is and avoid it if you're doing contrast studies. Now, when you order CTs with contrast of the abdomen, you'll see a comment on there if they note the artery of Adamkiewicz. Okay, so that's what it is. All right. So we talked about the rexed lamina. So here they are here, and what they do again, it's the characteristics of the cells. Or the cells could be large, the cells could be small. Large cells you're going to see in lamina 9 down here, see here in the ventral horn. Small, tiny cells are going to be up in the gray matter of the dorsal horn, which is, these mostly are relay neurons involved in sensation. I put this on the last night, I added this. Here's an example of where they've used a stain that highlights lamina 2. So this is called the substantia gelatinosa up here. You see how using certain types of stains or lesions or whatever, that you can really highlight the different lamina. So this is a substantia gelatinosa. These lamina are arranged like this. 1 through 6 is essentially in the dorsal horn. And they're responsible for relay of sensory information, somatic and visceral. One of them I want to highlight here. So here's that lamina 2, substantia gelatinosa, that we saw in the previous slide. Down here in lamina 5, it says right here, visceral somatic pain signals converge in lamina 5. So what that means is, if you have referred pain, if you have an abscess on the top of the liver, where do you feel the pain?
The right shoulder.
So this is one hypothesis. It may be more than a hypothesis, but this is one way that referred pain is thought to happen. All your life, you've felt pain, you've felt things on your shoulder, right? But rarely do you feel things with the upper part of your liver. But when something does happen with the upper part of your liver, you're used to that pain being related to your shoulder. Because what happens is the nerve from your shoulder . This is your shoulder, and this is your liver. Converge on the same neuron. So when that neuron relays the information to your brain is trained to think it's coming from the shoulder. Same thing happens with your heart, your gallbladder, your appendix, everything. And this has been shown physiologically. They put recorders, probes in. They can place a probe inside that cell and then stimulate these two areas, and that cell will fire from both areas. So there's physiological evidence that this exists, and it exists in lamina 5. Right. While we're at it, the other theory about referred pain is that you have one neuron that goes to both places. There's anatomical evidence that exists. So which one is correct, or are both correct? We'll go with both being correct. Okay? Moving down into the lateral gray column, remember that the lateral gray includes the intermediolateral cell column, which is where the preganglionic, sympathetics, and parasympathetics are. So that's the intermediolateral nucleus, or intermediolateral cell column right there. These are your visceral efferents. Lamina 10 is right around the central canal, because visceral afferent sensation visceral afferent sensation, reflex visceral afferent sensation, meaning how fast your heart is beating, how dilated your blood vessels are, and so on, synapses in lamina 10. So think of 7 and 10 as visceral related. Okay? And then you've got 8 and 9 down here. These are the big motor neurons that are going to skeletal muscle. Onus nucleus down here in the sacral spinal cord is related to pelvic function. Motor neurons are here. These are all multipolar. They're large. They have multiple dendrites. They have one axon. The axon can be distinguished from all of the dendrites when you look at a cross-section of the cell, because the dendrites, you see how this reddish stuff is called Nissl substance. You see how the Nissl substance goes up into the dendrite? It doesn't go into the axon. This clear area right here is called the axon hillock. Not that you would ever, ever need to know that for any reason for the rest of your life, including the first test, but it is kind of a unique feature of axons. Now, clinicians and scientists figured out how the nervous system works, they did it hundreds of years ago. Before the electron microscope, before all these tracing methods, before all the electrophysiology, they had already figured it out. They mapped these tracts of the brain and spinal cord years ago, centuries ago. It's impressive. And the way they did it was that they developed stains that either stained the cell body or stained myelin. So if you have somebody with a stroke, the stroke is up here, and what it's going to do is it's going to kill the cell bodies up here and the axons that are in the brainstem and spinal cord. So when that person died, they sliced up their nervous system, stained it, and voila, here's the normal pyramid, and we'll do the pyramids on Thursday. Here's one that's degenerated. So if a person had a stroke in the left parietal lobe, the pathway involved must be the right pyramidal, right pyramid. So amazingly, most of the things that we know of were elucidated centuries ago by these types of studies. Okay? Lesion studies is how they're described. Okay. Here are the tracks of the white matter that we're going to cover. There are ascending tracks taking information up to the cortex, descending tracks bringing it down. The ascending tracks we're going to talk about are the dorsal columns, which occupy the posterior funiculus. Now, there are two parts to the dorsal column. There's the fasciculus gracilis and the fasciculus cuneatus. Fasciculus gracilis and fasciculus cuneatus. If you look up here, remember that septum that split the dorsal column? That septum like that? This is the fasciculus gracilis. That's the fasciculus cuneatus. So this is the midline. I always remember this by gonorrhea. GC. GC. Put the G in the middle, which is where you find it. In the middle. GC. Okay?
Wait, so what? How does that relate to gonorrhea?
Where do you get gonorrhea?
Oh, okay.
In the middle.
Okay, yeah.
So the other way, it would be, if you get it to the other side, it would be G,
yeah.
C. Okay? So put the gracilis in the middle. All right. It might not work for you, it works for me. All right? fasciculus because they have light functions. The gracilis carries sensation of the lower extremity. The cuneatus carries sensation from the upper extremity. As a matter of fact, the cutoff is T6, the sixth thoracic spinal cord segment. So from here up, you'll have the gracilis and cuneatus, right? From here down, you'll only have the gracilis. Does that make sense? You know that the upper extremity is C5 to T1, so that's the cuneatus. The dorsal column transmits specific touch pressure, two-point discrimination, and vibration, and proprioception. I don't know if I said that already. So all of those sensations are carried over axons in the dorsal column. And when I say specific touch, if I come over here and have you close your eye, and I touch a single hair, and I say, with your other finger, point to where I touch you, she could point to that hair. Very specific touch. Now, these are not all carried over the same axon. In fact, they're carried over different axons. But all of those axons are arranged in these fascicles. Now, the other ascending tract here is called the lateral spinothalamic tract. There's an anterior spinothalamic tract we're not going to talk about. The lateral spinothalamic tract is the main one. And sometimes you'll hear it referred to as the anterior lateral system. It's on another slide, so you'll see it later on. But I prefer lateral spinothalamic tract. So it is a large tract here, right there. It's in the lateral funiculus. What's carried over that tract will be pain, temperature, and crude touch. So if I touch T's hair and I ask her and could isolate that tract and say, where did I touch you? She would say, somewhere in here. Very crude. And lastly, you have spinocerebellar tracts. There's a dorsal and a ventral spinocerebellar tract. We'll just consider them as one. One of the good things about neuroanatomy is they name a lot of these things from where they started to where they're going. So if it's a spinocerebellar tract, what do you think it's doing? It's going from the spine to the cerebellum. Wow, if you hadn't already had a cap, I'd give you another one. No, I mean, what would it be doing? What's the cerebellum function? What's the function of the cerebellum?
Coordination and balance.
What type of sensory information deals with coordination and balance?
Proprioception.
So the joint receptors, the sensory receptors that are in your joint capsules that tell how much stretch or flexion is put on a joint, that information goes to the cerebellum for integration into balance and movement. It's not brought to consciousness. This is like getting on a bike and riding it. This is a reflex. Walking up those stairs. You don't have to stop. You don't have to think about walking up those stairs. Well, what's the difference between that proprioception and the proprioception of the dorsal columns. That is, if I ask you, Bethany, where is your left leg? You know it's right there without having to look at it. That's dorsal column. Walking out that door, the spinal cerebellum. Now the descending tracts, the main descending tract is the lateral corticospinal tract, and it's a monster. It's huge. The lateral corticospinal tract is your, there's an anterior corticospinal tract we're not going to talk about, but the lateral spinal corticospinal tract comes from the cortex to the spinal cord. It is your main tract for volitional movement. It's your main descending pathway for volitional movement. If I ask you to pick up that urn, you could do it, okay? You would signal those clusters of lamina 9 neurons at the appropriate segments of the spinal cord, which would be upper extremity, C5 to T1, to pick up that urn. Or whatever you call those things.
Water bottle.
Water bottle. Yeah. Like you don't have like a normal one, like that's a
pizza
cutter. Okay, that's I can't believe that a Yeti ice chest is like $300. That's nuts. Anyway. So this is volitional. This is volitional. You order it to do things. The next three, the rubrospinal, the studiospinal, and tectospinal, are not volitional. These are descending pathways that modulate movement. That's a term we're going to talk about a lot here, is modulation. Because very few things in the nervous system act alone. There's a primary system, but then there are tons of systems that modulate the output of the primary system. And this is one example here. The rubrospinal tract goes from, rubro being red, goes from the red nucleus to the spinal cord. The red nucleus is associated, is located in a part of the brainstem we'll talk about Thursday, it's called the mesencephalon. It's a descending motor modulatory tract. It modulates flexion of the, primarily of the upper extremities, flexion. The vestibulospinal tract goes from the vestibular nuclei, from the vestibular cochlear nerve. So it's related to balance. The tectospinal tract goes from an area that's involved in visual pathways. And it's really confined to the cervical cord. Let me just throw this out here. This is a pretty complex question. What do you think the purpose of the tectospinal tract would be? Not to noise. To visual stimuli. I said it was related to vision. It's only in the cervical cord, which innervates your neck muscles. Your neck turns, your head turns from the corticospinal tract. Because if I say, April, turn your head, that's the one that's turning your head. But if you happen to be walking your dog, and all of a sudden there's a pit bull running out, you know, comes in this, in your field of vision, you quickly turn your head towards it. Reflexively turn your head toward it. That's tectospinal modulating the action of the corticospinal in response to a visual stimulus. You also have one of those related to hearing that we'll talk about later. But this one I wanted to focus on. So you see, you have these other tracts that modulate movement. If I said, pick up the water bottle, okay? And she did that. Why did she not do this? Why did she say, okay, I'm going to voluntarily pick up that water bottle, right? And she did it nice and smooth. Why does she not do this? Fire every corticospinal axon that goes to that upper extremity and why did she not do that?
Very good response.
Because all of these other tracks, she actually did in her brain. Everything fired. But she shut it down. She shut them down so that only that many fired. Okay? That's kind of cool, huh? It's a little bit of an over-exaggeration, but it actually, you don't fire everything, but that's really the way it is. So you have all of these tracks, and I've only listed three. There are dozens that modulate movement. And this modulation is coming from up here. It's not coming from down in the spinal cord, it's coming from up here. We'll get into more of that here in just a little bit. So when you look at a cross-section of the spinal cord, understand that the ratio of gray to white matter differs, depending on where you are. There are three areas that are most notable. One is down here in the sacrum. You have very little sensory fibers down there, and you have very few descending fibers that are down there, so you don't have much white matter. You have a relatively large amount of gray matter going to your pelvic diaphragm, your zener diaphragm, visceral functions. So the ratio of gray to white matter is quite high in the sacrum. In two areas of the spinal cord, up in the low cervical region and down in the low lumbar region, this is where you have the highest density of motor neurons going to the upper extremities and lower extremities. So there's so many of them, it actually enlarges the cord. You have a huge ventral horn. It's called cervical enlargement and the lumbar enlargement. Down here in the thoracic region, you see you don't have much in the way of muscles to supply, so you have very thin, tiny ventral horns. Those would be the intercostal muscles. That's all they're going to supply. So you've got a cervical enlargement, a lumbar enlargement. If you look at actual cross-sections, now these are not the same magnification, so that's blown up too much right there, that's sacrum. You can see these large ventral horns in the cervical and lumbar regions. If you take sections through the cord, here is the low cervical cord. So what we see here, there's the septum right there dividing the gracilis from cuneatus. So I can look at that section and know that it was above T6. Because it involves the upper extremity, you've got this huge ventral horn to go along with it. Below T6, you only have a single cuneatus. You have a single cuneatus. And by the way, if you look at the dorsal columns, so you've got the Gracilis is the lower extremity, cuneatus is upper extremity. What did I just say?
You said gracilis.
I said gracilis, right here, okay. So what happens is, as these sensory nerves pop, did that make sense?
Yeah.
Below T6 is only gracilis. Yeah, okay. I think I said cuneatus, yeah, it's gracilis. So, down around your anus, the sensory nerves around your anus, which is your lowest spinal cord segments, and they go into the spinal cord, and they're going to arrange themselves most medially. And then as you start climbing up the segments, those axons pile in from medial to lateral. So if I were to look at this thing right here, at this level of the cord, I would say that like the coccygeal, S234, those sensory nerves are here. Out in here is going to be the sensory nerves of my lower extremity. Now, why do I make that distinction? Well, most of the nervous system is somatotopic. It's somatotopically arranged. You don't have axons just bloop all over the place in there. They're very precisely arranged. So that I know that your body is represented. When you get all the way up here, if I get all the way up here, back up in the cervical region, I know there's my anus, there's my pudendal area, there's my lower extremity, here is my upper chest, here is my arm, here is my neck. So it's like if you were gonna put yourself there, if Paul were down here, no, we don't actually do it. If we were to bend over butt to butt, that's what the posterior columns would look like, right? It's a representation of the body onto a neuroanatomical structure. It's somatotopic. By the way, that's called an homunculus, a cartoon or a description of the bodies onto a neuroanatomical structure is called an homunculus. We'll see it later on. But you understand, we have to put our butt to butt and bend up. He'd bend it over that way. All right? Why do I make this distinction? Because a lesion here is going to produce a different defect than a lesion here. So if a person presents with a loss of sensation in the right upper extremity to touch, vibration, proprioception, I know where the lesion is. Versus if they lost saddle numbness, meaning like if you were to sit on a saddle, you're numb in that area, is the cauda equina syndrome. Where's the problem? The problem is going to be in here, not out here. There was a case involving a PA working in the jail that missed cauda equina syndrome in a prisoner that wound up dying. But what happened was he had a growth on his a meningioma out here that was pressing down on his cord from above, affecting those deep or low spinal cord segments. He had no other issue. He just presented with saddle numbness. Okay? All right. Clark column is related to the spinocerebellar tracts. They're right here. You can see them quite prominently right here. Clark's column. You get down into the low lumbar region, massive ventral horns, massive ventral horns. And in the sacrum, you're gonna get the lateral horn from the intermediate lateral cell column. S2-3-4. Parasympathetics. You see there's very little white matter here because there's very little, there are very few dermatomes that you're receiving sensation from at this level. Okay, you need to take a break. All right, take a break and then we'll come back.
Great.